morning.
Good morning.
We'd like to welcome Reverend Karen Pershing here this morning. She serves as the Director of Community Initiatives at Project Hospitality, an RCA mission partner on Staten Island, dedicated to feeding the hungry, housing the homeless, and providing wraparound social services. She is also involved in disaster recovery work, co-chair of an interfaith coalition, and serves as the supervisor of the Reformed Church of Prince Bay. Please join me in our call to worship. God, your word is like a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Accept my offerings of peace, O Lord, and teach me your ordinance. Your decrees are my heritage forever. They are the joy of my heart. Amen. Our hymn of praise is Mighty to Save, page 611, verses 1 and 2.
Thank you.
Lord our God, we confess that we can be like seeds planted in shallow soil. We are enthusiastic to follow your word for a time, but our enthusiasm withers under the pressures of our lives. We believe in your word that we are to love our neighbors as ourselves and become forgetful when confronted with actual people who are difficult to love. Forgive us, Lord, and always bring us back to your way of love. We pray that you would make us like seeds planted in good soil, with deep roots, so that we may live out your word and bear fruit. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
This is the seed sown along the path. The
seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown.
Word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This story that Jesus tells about a sower is one of seven parables that he preaches to a crowd of people who are sitting on a beach as he speaks to them from a boat just a little ways off in the water. And the parables are meant to reveal something about the kingdom of heaven that is best expressed through metaphor. The word is like seeds that a farmer generously scatters. People who hear the word but don't believe are like those seeds on the path that never took root. People who hear the word and believe but then quickly fall away are like the seeds that fell on the rocky ground. People who hear the word and believe but become distracted by the cares of the world and the lure of wealth are like those seeds that fell among the thorns. And those people who hear the word and believe and then bear fruit, they are like the seeds that fell on the good soil and became a harvest. So what is this word that Jesus compares to a seed? The word is the answer to our biggest questions. Why are we here? What are people for? What is the meaning of life? And put simply, that word is love. We were planted on this earth to love God and love our neighbors. That's it. That is the word. And the word is love. Some people, upon hearing that love is the purpose of life, do indeed respond with a pshht. That is for kids' stories. That is for the naive. That love stuff is for the weak. Some people believe the meaning of life is for love of God and neighbor, but do fall away when the evil and cruelty of the world scorch their hope like a hot sun on plants with shallow roots. And some people believe in the word of love, but do indeed fall victim to the love of money and the love of other things over the love of God and neighbor. But those who not only believe we're here to love God and our neighbors, but then actually use their lives to do that, those are the seeds that grow deep roots in good soil and bless others. I suspect each one of us here in church believes the purpose of life is to love God and neighbor. But when it comes to actually doing that loving, each one of us bears fruit some of the time, and each one of us withers some of the time, or maybe gets a bit tangled up with the things of the world that compete for our love. We are sinners in need of God's grace at the same time as we are the beloved children of God, made in God's image and made for love. And to be honest, there's a messiness to life, to learning how to love actual other people. And we all have certain people that we find it difficult to love. We're all on a learning journey when it comes to moving from the idea of love to actually loving the 8 billion other people on this earth who share the soil with us. The social service agency that I work for, Project Hospitality, is what's called a settlement house. The settlement movement began in the late 19th century as an effort to alleviate poverty and to reform the institutions and the laws that perpetuate cycles of poverty. So the idea was that people with some higher education or from a more middle-class background would choose to live or to settle in the poor neighborhoods they sought to serve, but also to learn from, living there as friends and as neighbors. Oftentimes, these communities brought together people of different races, religions, classes, languages spoken. And rather than seeing themselves as givers of charity to poor immigrants, the middle-class settlers strove to adopt a spirit of humility, knowing they had to learn before they could give appropriately. They understood that none of us are free and flourishing until all of us are free and flourishing. So recently, our settlement house has faced a new challenge as New York City has received a record number of asylum seekers, some of whom were indeed put on buses from Texas. And as a right to shelter city, our local government right now is scrambling to create accommodations for 80,000 migrants who have come through New York City shelters since the spring of 2022. Project Hospitality, my organization, currently oversees 2 hotels on Staten Island to shelter recently arrived families. And while our clients come from countries all across the world, many of our clients have specifically come here from Venezuela. And while I would not share any of my own client stories out of respect for their privacy, I would like to share with you today the story of one family that was highlighted in the New York Times with their permission. This is the true story of a 6-year-old girl named Sarah Suarez. Sarah's mom was a lawyer in Venezuela, but their country's authoritarian government and economic collapse led Ms. Suarez to the decision that the best possible thing she could do for her daughter's future would be to seek asylum in the United States, despite knowing how dangerous that journey would be. They sold everything they had, including their plastic Christmas tree, and left their home with only $820 in cash and their passports. This route requires crossing a brutal jungle called the Darien Gap. Sarah and her mom joined a group of 9 other migrants, and as a group, they handed $1,200 to a guide to lead them through just their first couple of days. On the second day of their journey, Sarah and her mother saw a body decomposing in a tent. On the third day, they paid local inhabitants $10 for a 90-second boat ride over a river. And on day 4, they camped in a town where, in the nighttime, the local inhabitants encircled them with wire and then forced each person to pay $20 to be able to leave. Then, just before reaching a towering mudslick mountain known as the Hill of Death, Sarah and her mother lost each other. Miss Suaro's feet were so blistered that she could barely walk, and she asked a friend on the route named Angel to carry her daughter through the mud. He turned a corner with Sarah on his shoulders, waiting for her mother, but she was gone. Others around them were collapsing from exhaustion, and they had to keep going, sometimes crawling on all fours over fallen trees. To ease her terror, Sarah sang through her tears, and this is what she sang. The glory of God, giant and sacred, he carries me in his arms. The glory of God, giant and sacred, he carries me in his arms. Angel lost all his clothes, all his money, his passport, while crossing one of the many rivers with Sarah on his shoulders. A few days later, they reached a migration checkpoint toward the end of the jungle where officials separated Sarah from Angel and put her in a room with other children who had lost their parents. Then Sarah's mom appeared, and she scooped her up in her arms, assuring her she had not abandoned her. She'd fallen behind and done everything she could to keep up on feet that she could barely stand on. 2 days after Sarah and her mom made it out of the Darien jungle on October 10, 2022, U.S. immigration policy for Venezuelans changed. Instead of being able to enter the U.S. and petition for asylum, Venezuelans coming to the U.S. border would be sent to Mexico. Only 24,000 Venezuelans would be given legal entry from abroad with the requirement that they have a U.S. sponsor to financially support them. So in their case, Sarah and her mom ended up in a migrant camp in Honduras, trying to get enough money to go back to square one in Venezuela. The UN estimates that at least 60,000 children, like Sarah, will cross the Darien Gap in 2023. And some of those very children who made it to the United States are sleeping in the Comfort Inn Hotel on Staten Island, the shelter overseen by my organization. Some families came to us wearing the same clothes they wore throughout that journey. Many are sick right now, nursing horribly wounded feet. And several of the women are pregnant and nearing their due dates right now. I am a social services director at a settlement house, and I am a Christian, and I believe the word of Jesus. I believe that the purpose of life is to love God and neighbor. And I know the Venezuelan asylum seekers in New York City are my neighbors. And it's messy. In this messy lived reality, how do I love them? What should my love look like? I don't even know how to speak Spanish. I don't know very much about immigration law. And I don't want to be some white savior congratulating myself for bestowing charity on poor immigrants. I want to be like Jesus, even when I'm really not sure how. What would Jesus do? We know what Jesus did in his brief human life. What he did was to be with the people on the margins. The crowds of people sitting on that beach to hear him preach in parables, those were country people, peasants, the ethnic and religious minority kept in poverty by an oppressive Roman government. He lived with them. He talked to them. He put his hands on their bodies to heal them. They felt his love. They wanted to be close to him because they knew that love was real. Jesus didn't just believe the purpose of life is to love God and neighbor. He lived that way. So in all the messes we find ourselves in, may we seek to be like Jesus. When the cruelty of the world has withered us, may we seek Jesus. When thorns are choking us, may we seek Jesus. And when our roots feel shallow and we're just kind of uncertain how to love, may we seek Jesus to show us the way. Sticking with this whole plant metaphor, I have to believe that human beings are perennials. We have seasons in life in which we feel withered. But by God's grace, we are able to blossom again. We follow a resurrected Savior after all. And if we fall away from the way of love, we can come back. If we fail to put love into action, or even lose our belief in God and in love altogether, God's arms remain open. So like Jesus, may we seek ways that we can be with our neighbors on the margins. May we seek to not only believe the word, but to live it. And may God grow us into having deep roots in good soil so that we would bear good fruit.
Thank you.
profess our faith in God together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Final and complete end
and the evil of racism. God, we pray specifically for asylum seekers, for all who are forced to flee from their homes, from government collapse, economic collapse, for whatever reason, God, we know that but by your grace, we could be in their very shoes. And we are bound together as one human family who you have called us to care for one another. May we show hospitality. May we show welcome and care and love. And when we're not sure how to do those things, we look to you, God, in your grace, to show us the way forward. We pray all these things using the words that your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn of dedication is Be Thou My Vision, number 815.
Let us go forth to love and serve the Lord.